who was mission specialist for the ST-41D mission on her first flight, is in the White Room now preparing to put on her egress harness and get ready for her entrance into the orbiter. On her first flight, three satellites were deployed, and she was responsible for operating the remote manipulator arm on that particular flight. She's also responsible for operating the arm for placing the Spartan Halley spacecraft in orbit and then recovering it later in flight. That will be put in orbit over the side on the second day. The orbiter will move about 5 miles away and allow it to function and look at Halley's comet for 40 hours and then go back and pick it up and bring it back to Earth. Her undergraduate degree was from Carnegie Mellon University, and she earned her PhD in electrical engineering from the University of Maryland. Prior to joining NASA in 1978 as a mission specialist, Judy Resnick worked as a senior systems engineer in product development for the Xerox Corporation in California. She's a native of Akron, Ohio, and also a classical pianist, and enjoys flying and bicycling in her spare time. Ellison Onizuka, also in the White Room. Actually, everybody's going to be in there shortly as they get ready. The teacher observer, Krista McAuliffe, has been handed an apple by the closeout crew. Ellison Onizuka now getting his egress harness on. The native of Hawaii is a graduate of Kona Waena High School and earned both a Bachelor and Master of Science degree in Aerospace Engineering from the University of Colorado. After receiving his commission in the Air Force, he served as a flight test engineer and participated in the flight programs and system safety engineering for a wide variety of aircraft. He graduated from the Air Force Test Pilot School and then served on the staff. Onizuka is one of the astronauts known as the Cape Crusaders, who were assigned to KSC for a period of time of several launches and work with the orbiter test and checkout teams and the launch support crews. The astronaut support person on board, Sonny Billy Bob Carter, is also one of the Cape Crusaders at the present time. Astronauts are frequently assigned to work within the many technical areas which are essential to successful flights and help carry that information they're learning back to the flight crews, and of course it becomes useful to them as well. Onizuka's first flight was aboard the 51C mission, which was dedicated to the Department of Defense. Payload specialist Ron McNair up near the hatchway. He'll be getting ready shortly also to enter the cabin. And Greg Jarvis in the back of it, nearest the cabin. Dr. Ron McNair last flew on the STS-41B mission, which deployed two satellites and also was the first flight of the manned maneuvering unit and the first use of the Canadian developed remote manipulator system to position an astronaut at various locations in the cargo bay. This work led to the successful use of the arm in capturing and repairing satellites in orbit. McNair earned his PhD in physics from the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, where he was involved in the early development of chemical and high-pressure carbon dioxide lasers. In 1976, he became a staff physicist with Hughes Research, working with lasers and also doing research on electro-optical laser modulation for satellite communications. Dr. McNair also holds a number of honorary degrees. as many people as possible are crowding into the white room on the 195-foot level of the pad today because of the very cold temperatures out there. The temperature is about 24 degrees on the pad at that particular level, and it's not going to be all that warm in the cabin. There is a air supply, a heated air supply that goes into it, which supplies air at about 70 degrees to the cabin. However, the cabin temperature is about 61 degrees. Hopefully, as the crew gets in, that will warm up a bit. As each of the crew members boards the orbiter, they begin to check out their communication system. However, it'll be a little later in the count where they'll go through a formal check of communications, the air to ground, both one and two, and the then simultaneously with Houston and the firing room. In the foreground now, preparing to put on their egress harnesses is Greg Jarvis and Krista McAuliffe. Krista McAuliffe was selected out of 11,000 teacher applicants as the first private Another course which she was involved in the development of is one called Success, and is a team teaching approach to working with youngsters who are not motivated towards school studies, in helping them understand the relationship between school and the real world, and the advantages which they can gain to making their way in the world through education. Hughes payload specialist Greg Jarvis, who is closest to the camera now, was born in Detroit, Michigan, and he's a graduate of the State University in Boston as well. And he's presently completing another degree in management science at West Coast University in after joining Hughes, for whom he is flying as their payload specialist. He first worked as a subsystem engineer on the Marisat program. He was test and integration manager for the F-1 and F-2 LeeSat spacecraft, which have been successfully deployed from the shuttle. The countdown continuing very smoothly here at the Kennedy Space Center while the crew members of 51L get ready and get in board the orbiter Challenger. There have been many other things that have been happening while they have been on their way to the pad and out at the pad. Among those has been a check of the first motion system, which is a signal that starts the mission elapsed time counter both on board and at Houston. The ground launch sequencer program has been started in the integration console here in the firing room, and engineers are setting up the specific tables in the launch processing system that the ground launch sequencer will use as its guidelines to either let the countdown continue or call an automatic hold when it assumes control of the countdown at the T-minus 9-minute mark. Everything proceeding smoothly at T-minus 1 hour, 48 minutes, 50 seconds and counting. This is shuttle launch control. This is shuttle launch control at T-minus 1 hour, 40 minutes, and counting. All of the crew members, with the exception of Dr. Ron McNair, are on board the Orbiter Challenger now, and all of them have checked in, with the exception of Greg Jarvis and Ron McNair, with the Orbiter test conductor, Roberta Wyrick. He'll be climbing in soon. Most of the crew members have brought gloves with them for this particular launch today. The temperature on board the orbiter just a little bit above 60 degrees, although the temperature flowing in through the ducting, which is left in place until the hatch is closed, is at the 70 degree level. We have just passed the point where, if it were necessary, that we would realign the inertial measurement units on the inertial upper stage, which will be used to place the TDRS, or the Tracking and Data Relay Satellite, in orbit. The initial alignment of those inertial measurement units occurs at around the T-minus 11-hour point, and has gone satisfactorily, or we would have had a second opportunity to do that. The countdown going very smoothly here at the Kennedy Space Center. The weather cooperating. We're expecting clear skies, light winds from the northwest, and good visibility. Continuation of the comm checks, which are going on between the orbiter, the firing room here at Kennedy Space Center, and Houston. PS2, who is checking in, is Greg Jarvis. PS1 was Krista McAuliffe. The countdown clock continuing at T-minus 1 hour, 37 minutes, 35 seconds and counting. This is Shuttle Launch Control.
LTD, MS-3, contact.
MS-3,
this is Shuttle Launch Control at T-minus 1 hour, 29 minutes and counting. The all seven members of the 51L flight crew are now in the shuttle, and the orbiter test conductor is verifying with the orbiter system engineers that they're ready to close the crew hatch. Before the hatch is closed, the closeout crew will remove items not needed for the mission, such things as helmet visor protectors, checklist, and switch guards. Once the hatch is closed and locked in place, special plugs of insulating tile material will be screwed into place and fastened on carrier plates. Checks of the astronaut communication channels have started between the crew and the firing room, and checks with mission control over the air-to-ground loops are also underway. These checks verify that all the primary and backup communication channels are functional between the crew, ground facilities, and mission control in Houston. The weather officer has indicated a warming trend is taking place, and that by 10 o'clock that it could reach 32 degrees here at the Kennedy Space Center. That's rather unusual for Florida, but we're hoping to get into the upper 40s at the high point for the day. The winds are from the northwest, about 10 knots, gusting to 14. This provides just a minor headwind, basically, for a return to launch site abort, should that be necessary, on runway 33. The weather at Dakar is satisfactory, with high cirrus clouds and some scattered clouds, but the visibility is above 5 miles and satisfactory. Casablanca is no-go because of a front that is pushed through there, leaving clouds in the area. The launch window for today's launch is expected to extend to 1:38 if necessary. However, at the present time, we're expecting liftoff on time at 10:38 a.m. Eastern Time this morning.
Closeout isn't working.
flight crew, I'll be going to air ground 2 first, then ICOM A and B, and then UHF, and back to air ground 1.
This is Shuttle Launch Control at T-minus 1 hour, 19 minutes, 48 seconds, and counting. Astronaut support person, Sonny Billy Bob Carter, has left the crew module, and the orbiter test conductor, Marsha Ivins, Roberta Wyrick, has given the closeout crew permission to close the hatch for flight. During this period, all of the things which are used for loading the crew on board is taken out of the orbiter. This includes platforms which are used for climbing in through the hatch to prevent any damage that might occur to the areas. As well as the tools which are taken on board to help with getting the flight crew into their seats and ensuring that they are properly adjusted. The pedals for the steering of the orbiter have to be adjusted to the length of the pilot and commander's legs, and the various other tools are on board in case of emergencies and hooking up either the communications or the oxygen supply. The announcement from the Mission Control Center in Houston that the air-to-ground voice checks are complete and they're receiving all of the crew members loud and clear. Just a couple of minutes, the closeout crew will take out the air supply tube, which has been supplying 70 degree air into the cabin, and will be closing the cabin door and preparing the white room for launch. Cleaning of the seal area around the door has been underway, and it's possible that the crew may want to have the air supply in for a slightly longer period because of the very cold temperatures at the pad. The shuttle landing facility 4 miles from the pad, the landing support convoy is now being positioned, and that convoy would support the shuttle orbiter if it had to return to the Kennedy Space Center for any reason. The countdown clock continuing at T-minus 1 hour, 17 minutes and counting. This is shuttle launch control. T-minus 15 seconds. T-minus 10, 9, 8, 7, 6. We have main engine start, 4, 3, 2, 1, and liftoff. Liftoff of the 25th Space Shuttle mission, and it has cleared the tower.
Roll program confirmed. Challenger now heading down range. Engines beginning throttling down now at 94%. Normal throttles for most of the flight, 104%. We'll throttle down to 65% shortly. Engines at 65%, three engines running normally, three good fuel cells, three good APUs. Velocity, 2,257 feet per second. Altitude, 4.3 nautical miles. Downrange distance, 3 nautical miles. Engines throttling up, three engines now at 104%.
Challenger, go at throttle up.
Challenger, go at throttle up.
Minute 15 seconds. Velocity 2,900 feet per second. Altitude 9 nautical miles. Downrange distance 7 nautical miles. Here looking very carefully at the situation. Obviously a major malfunction. We have no downlink. Dynamics officer that the vehicle has exploded. Flight director confirms that. We are looking at checking with the recovery forces to see what can be done at this point. Contingency procedures are in effect. Available. Again, to repeat, we have a report relayed through the flight dynamics officer that the vehicle has exploded. We are now looking at all the contingency operations and awaiting word from any recovery forces in the downrange field. This is Mission Control Houston. We have no additional word at this time. Reports from the flight dynamics officer indicate that the vehicle apparently exploded and that impact in the water at a point approximately 28.64 degrees north, 80.28 degrees west. We are awaiting verification from as to the location of the recovery forces in the field to see what may be possible at this point. And we will keep you advised as further information becomes available. This is Mission Control.